Welcome, Constables, Robomen, and Masters of Earth, to the 123rd episode of An Unearthly Podcast, streaming live on the 2nd of September, 2015, and featuring Daleks, Invasion Earth 2150 AD, written by Milton Subotsky and David Whittaker. I am Bill Sylvia, the Man in Black, and with me are Mad Matt Winchell.
Right said Fred.
Randy Ronson McCulloch.
Always a pleasure.
Aaron Romeo Moon Burke.
Hello.
And Tim the Enchanter Sheridan.
Yo!
All right. One of the things, Matt, yes, that was entirely too long.
It was still fun, though.
And whoever dropped a can during the opening... Yeah, that came through loud and clear.
What? Oh, I didn't hear anything.
I heard something.
Okay.
I heard a couple things, anyway.
So,
must be unprofessional?
Where's that?
Well, considering we're not getting paid, there goes professional out the window anyway.
Yeah, you pay me, then I'll sit down and edit that thing better.
I'm as professional as I can be sitting here with almost finishing a margarita.
Yes, you heard it right here, folks. Our host, our leader here is a drunkie.
At least he's not looking for his last shaker of salt.
All right, so we have a lot of news, so we got to get booking here.
Yeah.
The first thing we're going to start with is birthdays, and we've got one non-Doctor Who birthday. Actress Laura Palmer, who is best known as Irene Adler on BBC Sherlock, and several other shows as well, turned 35 yesterday on September 1st. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Also, our own resident drunkie and... main lead host, Bill, turned 27 on Sunday, the August 30th. Happy birthday, Bill. How was it?
It was all right. Had wings, which is generally our tradition on birthdays, thanks to the multiple bars that give away free wings for your age on your birthday.
So you can barf spicy.
See, here in Madison, we have a place that a bar and grill designed specifically for birthdays, and they're actually known for having fairly decent burgers.
Ah.
I never knew about that, but okay.
You'd never heard of the Nitty Gritty, Matt? I mean, you lived here for a few years.
I've heard of the Nitty Gritty, but I've never really gone to it, and no one ever took me.
It used to be where we dead dogged the first couple years of GeekCon.
Yeah, and usually those are also during, you know, when I was working and school and stuff at the same time. So I never had time to go to the Dead Dogs.
Remember when Matt had a job? Remember when he was attending school at one point?
Yeah.
Remember when life made sense?
I have
that's out a long time ago.
Because he had Shepherd a job Farmer. A lot later than I had a job. Anyway, we need to move on because, well, news a lot.
As with life, so comes death. Unfortunately, we must announce the death of Wes Craven, creator of Nightmare on Elm Street and Scream. He died from brain cancer at the age of 76 on Sunday, August 30th.
And many, many other...
There's a gaping hole in the horror world now.
Yeah, he pretty much redefined...
Didn't he do Deadly Friend?
What horror was.
Twice.
Deadly Blessing...
Deadly
the last
friend.
House on the left.
The hills have eyes.
The people under the stairs.
1982 Swamp Thing. Wow.
People under the stairs. Rainbow and the Serpent was a really good one, too.
Yeah, that was a good one.
That freaked the hell out of me. I saw that in my college years.
I saw that when I was a kid, because we used to live in New Orleans.
Unfortunately, a lot of his later stuff wasn't that good. I mean, you know, after the Scream movies, and those really kind of went downhill after the first couple of them, didn't they?
Yeah, but I don't think Wes Craven was behind those either, though.
Yes, he was.
Oh, he was? Yes.
Scream was really a deconstruction of the horror genre, too, a little bit.
I don't think he fell as far as Tim Burton, though.
Oh, no. No, yeah. Not as far as Tim Burton, no.
Hey, give Burton some credit. He has a lot farther to fall yet to go.
Oh, God. Can you fall any harder than Dark Shadows? I don't know.
Well, can you fall farther than M. Night Shyamalan?
Ooh. Now there's a fall.
Yeah.
He went up like a rocket and fell like a lead brick.
Yeah, let's not talk about that. Let's move on to the next piece of news.
Definitely sad loss, the creator of at least one of my favorite films of all time. Probably more if I actually were to list everything. But.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, let's move on to Series 9 news. The BBC have announced a special preview of the forthcoming series premiere will be taking place in Cardiff on the 10th of September. The event will see both The Magician's Apprentice and The Witch's Familiar presented by BAFTA Cymru. The double bill screening...
BAFTA Wales.
The double bill screening will be followed by a panel Q&A session with Peter Cabaldi, Jenna Coleman, and Stephen Moffat, joined by executive producer Brian Minchin. In addition to the special event, as the 19th of September gets closer, BBC Worldwide has begun to release viewing times for the Series 9 premiere on respective local channels. It will premiere in the UK at September 19th, time to be determined, announced, in the US and Canada on September 19th at 9 p.m. Eastern, in Asia, September 20th at 10 a.m. from 3 p.m. to 3 a.m.
The second times on those are compared to British Standard Time.
Okay.
So that's essentially saying U.S. and Canada will get it at 2 a.m. British Standard Time, Asia 3 a.m. Right. British Time. It's essentially to compare.
All right.
It's amazing how many of these are still to be announced.
Australia, September 20th. At 7:40 p.m. Eastern, 10:40 British Standard. New Zealand in September. Europe, September 22nd at 9 p.m. Finland at September 28th at 6. South Africa, October 24th at 6. India, it's coming soon in 2015. Germany in December to be determined. And Italy, early 2016, and it will be dubbed into Italian.
Yep, and so, by the way, those of you that are looking to see it earlier, you might be able to find a rip of it online somewhere in the 11th or 12th of September if somebody goes to the Cardiff showing with a camera hidden. Don't count on it, however. I think they're pretty good at screening those things.
Yeah. Now, while Germany might have to wait until winter to watch Series 9 on Fox, iTunes has jumped at the opportunity to be the first to air the German subtitled editions of this series. German-speaking fans will have access to each episode the day after it initially airs in the UK. A season pass is available for pre-order, similar to the English-language version. So, don't know where Fox Germany dropped the ball on that one, but iTunes was happy to pick it up.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So, while we're still looking for news on the season premiere and information on Series 9 in general, we are starting to get news for the 2015 Christmas special. As it is not yet filmed. Foremost among this news, and much to my personal displeasure, is the return of Alex Kingston as River Song, meaning that we will see her within a month of each other for appearances with both the 12th Doctor and then next month with the 8th Doctor in Big Finish Audio. This is personally something, like I said, I am disappointed in. It's showing to me that Moffat is had no time to write the Christmas special, so he's going back to his personal grab bag of quick and easy solutions. Expect to be disappointed and or pissed off by the Christmas special.
If you listen very closely, at you the can same hear the time, tears fall from Randy's cheeks onto his keyboard.
More of the burning rage.
And the seething disappointment.
Urged to kill Moffat rising again. Also at the same time, it's announced that Douglas That's also at this time it was announced that Douglas McKinnon will be returning to direct the Christmas special. Which episodes did he do previously?
I know he did the Centauran Stratagem and Flatline off the top of my head.
Centauran Stratagem wasn't bad.
Flatline they're not in that link. They're in a different link. That's not going to help you because I didn't.
That's okay. Centauran Stratagem was okay. Flatline was so-so. So it sounds like he can do a fairly decent job, but he might be handed a stealing pile of crap here.
And there's only so much you can do with a stealing pile of crap.
He directed Cold War, Listen, The Power of Three, Time Heist, Flatline, The Poison Sky, and The Centauran Stratagem. Flatline, I think, was pretty creatively directed. Time Heist, the most complaints I've heard were about its direction, but it was
people who hate the direction of that particular episode can go suck a big one.
I didn't have any particular issues with the direction of that episode. I was not, however, particularly impressed by the direction of that episode.
Yeah.
I was, however, impressed by the writing and the acting in it. So.
Oh, yes. And in order to get actors to cooperate, sometimes you need to have a good director.
Anyway, it has been suggested that Jenna Coleman saying she was abroad in social media might indicate she's not appearing in the Christmas special. It is also likely that this might be something Moffat told her to write as to put us all on the wrong track. However, we will see in the upcoming future. It also might be that she quickly was leaving a sinking ship. Really, Moffat? Seriously?
One thing I want to mention about River, I'm already seeing articles about how is it possible that she's coming back. I'm not sure if people understand the concept of time traveler.
I don't know if people understand the concept of Mary Sue.
No shit.
Yeah, it does seem that just as things are getting good, something has to happen to screw it all up.
Didn't Moffat say that he was trying to return to a more classic way of doing things?
More classic way of his way of doing things. Apply forehead to desk. Apply forehead to desk. Repeat, repeat, repeat.
Did he seriously think that Series 8 was that bad that he has to go back to square one?
No, I'm pretty sure his issue here is if you look at where the filming of Series 9 ended and where he had to start production for the Christmas special, he was given no time to write the Christmas special between writing the finale and this, so he had to quickly jot it off. And when
Which
he does
why
that, his writing gets cliched and crappy.
And shite. Which is why BBC needs to replace his dumb freaking ass. And put him only one bloody thing to work on.
He has stated that he seems rather tired of doing Doctor Who.
And keeps saying that, but he doesn't keep moving on!
Yeah.
Who could ever get tired of Doctor Who?
Apparently,
raising my hand. Raising my hand whenever it's written by Russell lately.
You mean Moffat?
Yeah.
I would love to see Russell write a couple episodes.
Russell come back? Yeah, I would love the Russell to come back at this point. Please, for the love of God.
Yeah. Come back, Russell.
Please, Russell, we need you. This show really needs you right now.
Nick Briggs for showrunner.
Hey!
Promotion from Dalek voice
though.
To showrunner.
I don't know, though. How's Nick Briggs' ability to write?
Doesn't he write most of the...
I seem to recall you and I disagreeing on that fact. Sirens of Time is one of the events that he's written. I'd have to look up a few of his other audios that he's written.
Because I remember when he wrote something, I tended to get more confused than anything else. Confuzzled.
Perplexed?
I mean,
anyway.
He is one of the executive producers at Big Finish, so he's still, you know, he is familiar with the at least part of the production aspect of the job, obviously not the visuals.
Yeah, that'd be the one thing.
I'm just more concerned because the fact that showrunner for Doctor Who is a little different from the executive producer job at Big Finish. because it also holds the title of lead writer and main script editor. I believe Bolt Big Finish actually keeps two separate positions for those, and executive producer is just more of a manager position there. Thus, I'm not sure if Briggs is up to
doing it. At least depending, according to employee accounts, was it Gary Russell before him? Before he came over to actually doing doing Doctor Who on television, they claimed that he was essentially producer, main writer, and main director all rolled into one. I don't know if Briggs doesn't wear the same hats because he also acts and such, but there's still a bit rolled up. I'm trying to find his writing credits. He has too many damn acting credits. Another voice in this franchise.
You should look at IMDb. They usually separate those things. Anyway, shall we move on?
Let's go on.
This has gone off into quite a tangent already.
So, biographies. Never One to Let a Gay Die, Peter Davison has announced his autobiography titled The Fifth-ish Doctor, making him the third Doctor to do so among Jon Pertwee and Tom Baker. The book, with a foreword by Davison's biggest fan, David Tennant, will hit the shelves on the 7th of April and will feature an 8-page color insert of Davison's biggest roles, including Doctor Who, as well as photographs from his personal collection, which have never been published before.
Hmm.
Oh. Right? Mm-hmm. That sounds like it could be pretty exciting. All right, and Peter Davison isn't the only one publishing work on his past. Bernard Wilkie, co-founder of the BBC's Visual Effects Department in 1954, and Robert Banks Stewart, writer of Terror of the Zygons, are both publishing memoirs in the near future through Meek Publishing.
I think it's like milk with a lisp. I'm not entirely sure, though.
Meek. From Wilkie comes A Peculiar Effect on the BBC later this month, while next month brings us to Put You in the Picture by Robert Banks Stewart. So?
Yep. Oh, that's nice.
Yes, questions, comments?
After that, I guess it's going to be Colin's turn.
I guess so. I don't know. Which one's off to see the Grim Reaper next?
Tom's been holding in there like a champ, though.
Yeah.
He's going to stick it through.
He wants to write a biography, not to die.
I don't know. Usually people only write their memoirs just before they die.
You realize that if we lose a doctor in the next few months, and it's one of those two, I'm going to blame the both of you, right?
Tom Baker wrote his in 1997.
Oh, okay.
Cool. Now, he wrote it right after another doctor died, so... but...
Yeah, but that was probably meant he was already writing it when...
True.
Something happened. Yeah.
Anyway.
And of course, he was still in his pissed off at Doctor Who mode and mostly left that out of his biography, apparently. But...
Well... Doctor Who, The Complete History, releases its first issue on the 9th of September. The Complete History is a series of episode archives that will be available monthly to subscribers in the UK. Each issue will feature 2 to 4 episode archives that are in sequence with one another, but unrelated to accompanying issues. The first issue will feature the first 4 stories of the 10th Doctor's second season, while issue 2 features the 3rd Doctor and the end of his second season and beginning of his 3rd. Issue 3 features the 12th Doctor's first 2 stories, and issue 4 does the same for the 4th Doctor. Unfortunately, there is still no word of this collection being available across the pond. If you are in the UK or Ireland, however, you can email comp-completehistory@doctorwhonews.net with the subject Complete History for a chance to win a full collection subscription to the series. You will want to include your name, address, the fact that you heard of the contest on an unearthly podcast, and the answer to the following question. The Complete History uses the title 100,000 BC. for one of the first Doctor stories, but what is the title more commonly known as? Good luck. From BBC Audio, we have two new releases, each complete with a worldwide competition. Both released tomorrow, as of this recording. The first is Robert Holmes' novelization of The Two Doctors, read by 6th Doctor Colin Baker, and the second is Ian Briggs' novelization of Curse of Fenric, read by Terry Malloy. Like with the previous contest, entrants must include their name, address, and where they heard of this contest. To win The Two Doctors, email comp-2doctorscd@doctorwhonews.net with the subject, "Yes, Jamie, it is a big one," ellipses. And the answer to the following question: what race does Jamie first misidentify Chesenne as before the 6th Doctor corrects him? To win Curse of Fenric, email comp-fenriccd@doctorwhonews.net with the subject, "Flip-flops are ace." The question for that contest is, what is the trigger word to release the toxin hidden inside the Ultima machine? And recently published by Peter Lang is Alex Charles' book Out of Time, The Deaths and Resurrections of Doctor Who. Doctor Who is one of television's most enduring and ubiquitously popular series. This study contends that the success of the show lies in its ability, over more than half a century, to develop its core concepts and perspectives: alienation, scientific rationalism, and moral idealism. The most extraordinary aspect of this eccentric series rests in its capacity to regenerate its central character and, with him, the generic, dramatic, and emotional parameters of the program. Out of Time explores the way in which the series' immortal alien addresses the nature of human mortality and its ambiguous relationships with time and death. It asks how the status of this protagonist, that lonely god, uncanny trickster, cyber-skeptic, and techno-nerd, might call into question the beguiling fantasies of immortality, apotheosis, and utopia, which his nemeses tend to pursue. Finally, it investigates how this paragon of transgenerational television reflects the ways in which contemporary culture addresses the traumas of change, loss, and death. Wow.
Deep.
Yeah. So I'm guessing that the trigger word hidden inside the Ultima machine is not paladin.
No, though I would like to make a correction on something you said in the earlier question.
Yeah.
Or in the earlier question, the character is Chesenne.
Chesenne. I'm sorry. Chesenne. Well, it is a big one, Jamie.
I don't think you've seen The Two Doctors. I think that was before we reviewed that one before you joined us. So
yeah.
I need to see it.
Yeah,
anybody else feel the Curse of Fenric being narrated by freaking Davros is fucking hardcore?
I don't know. Only if he does it in his Davros voice.
See, after listening to I, Davros, I'll hear it as his Davros voice no matter which voice he uses.
Yes, Jamie, it is a big one. Well, how big? It's as big as the Twinkie.
That's one hell of a Twinkie.
Tell them about the Twinkie. What about the Twinkie?
Well, continuing on to Kuwahara new release news. Big Finish Productions has released trailers for the first two audio dramas in their new Torchwood line. The Conspiracy featuring John Barrowman and Fall to Earth featuring... I'm sorry, I wrote his character name and not his real name.
God damn it, Bill.
Featuring Yanto Jones. I'll get his real name in a second. The trailers kind of give the impression that Conspiracy might be along the lines of a Body Snatchers type story, whereas Fall to Earth may actually be set after Children of Earth.
Wow.
And I'm sorry, Gareth David Lloyd is his real name.
Bad Bill.
And of course, there's... some new releases in Big Finish, the highest profile being the Third Doctor Adventures, which is the first full cast story featuring Tim Treloar as the Third Doctor. This box set features two stories. They normally have more, but it looks like it has two stories, which would be Prisoners of the Lake by Justin Richards, in which Captain Mike Yates is investigating the disappearance of artifacts from an archaeological site deep below Dunstanton Lake. It's hardly a job for UNIT, but when the team discover a mysterious ancient structures buried deep underwater, all that changes. When Chief Archaeologist Frida Mattingly ventures inside, she soon realizes that her skills do not begin to equip her to deal with what she finds. As an ancient menace begins to stir, the Doctor, Joe Grant, and Mike Yates must dive down to the lake bed and discover the secrets hidden there. Secrets that could mean the end of all life on Earth. The second story is The Havoc of Empires by Andy Lane. The Doctor and Joe take Mike Yates on his first trip in the TARDIS. Lots of love for Mike, apparently. But instead of the historical cricket match they were aiming for, they end up on a futuristic space station in the middle of a diplomatic crisis that might escalate into galactic war. The alien leader...
That's
you're gonna say what I'm thinking?
That's really kind of changing Mike Yates' role.
True.
Because he was never a big... He was never a TARDIS traveler prior to this.
Yeah, true. Well, I did say it's his first trip in the TARDIS. And I do know that, if I recall, the Brigadier never really intentionally travels in the TARDIS on screen, but he's considered a TARDIS traveler in Big Finish.
He's traveled in the TARDIS a couple times, sometimes not willingly, but he has traveled in the TARDIS.
Only, I think, in the Three Doctors and the Five Doctors.
Those are what I would know of, yeah.
Another one, I think, during the Fifth Doctor era.
I'm not sure if he did in...
Modern Undead, I'm not sure. Yeah, something happened there, but I'm not sure if he was in the TARDIS or if it was some other
He had to travel in the TARDIS at least twice in that.
But Mike Yates never did. I mean, he was there for the UNIT episodes of that season, that final season with the Doctor and Joe. But following the Green Death, he kind of went nuts and was forced to retire.
Well, if this is with Joe, it would be set before the Green Death.
Yeah, I know. But it would have had to have been during that season, because prior to that season, he didn't have the TARDIS. And then after that season, he kind of went nuts, so...
Yeah. And in other new releases, we have Short Trips Foreshadowing, which apparently I'm not sure if I gave Matt the link for. I do apologize if I deleted it instead of including it. Foreshadowing by Julian Richards, which has been released featuring Paul McGann. A young lieutenant is sent to interrogate two strangers who were apprehended whilst intruding at a secure RAF base. The man seems strangely familiar, could pass for Lord Byron, and says he's an alien. Meanwhile, his female friend is apparently from 1930. So Charlie, then, I'm thinking. As the lieutenant tries to find out what they're doing on his base, something connects them with a strange incident earlier in the day. Stories of a giant insect.
All right. Finally, we have related news, which is basically Doctor Who alumni that have gone on to do some other things. Starting off with Colin Baker, who seems to want to get into the same level of prestige as actors like Tim Curry and John Glover by playing a gigantic demon. He is going to be in Neighbors from Hell, which is a new horror comedy feature film by Amber Pictures. His character is described as an ancient demon intent on bringing about the apocalypse. It also stars Suzanne Shaw and Chris R. Wright, with more cast members being announced over the coming months. It is expected to be released in the autumn-winter 2016.
Interesting.
The trailer says, on the brink of divorce from his wife, Joanna, selfish slob Simon Fisher reluctantly agrees to attend a Halloween supper with his snobby next-door neighbors, Phil and Pam. When Simon and Joanna arrive, they meet the fifth guest, a mysterious old man. The stranger is, in fact, a demon, intent on imprisoning them in the house until midnight, when he will decide which one of them to possess for the next 100 years. A horror comedy that plays on prejudices we have for the people next door. Best to get to know your neighbors, as you may need them someday.
They called him the stranger. I'm sure it was an accident, but it's always a laugh.
Also, the article seems to have some wonderful pictures of him in his demon costume.
Yes.
Looking very kind of Tim Curry Labyrinth-esque, only without as big horns.
Labyrinth? You mean Legend?
Legend. Yes. Sorry. I always get those two confused when I say them. Okay. So, in other news, we were just discussing Russell T. Davies earlier. He is making his big return to the BBC, but he's not doing Doctor Who. He's doing Shakespeare. Charlotte Moore, the controller of BBC One, announced at Edinburgh Television Festival on Wednesday that Russell T. is to adapt William Shakespeare's A Midsummer Night's Dream for BBC One with the help of the Doctor Who production team. Davies was spotted in Cardiff with David Tennant earlier this month, which led to speculation amongst fans as to what the pair were doing in the city. The cast for A Midsummer Night's Dream is still to be announced.
That's obviously just like how people throw a fit every time a former cast member visits the set, because people aren't allowed to have lunch with their former colleagues or their friends unless there's a sinister motive behind it.
Okay, so quoting Russell T. here, he says, "I wanted to make this for the BBC my entire adult life, and only the BBC can put on a play like this for all the family, smack bang in the heart of prime time. With a riot of prosthetics, CGI, magic in action, it needs the brilliant Doctor Who team in Cardiff to bring it to life. For one night only, BBC One becomes the globe with a bold and accessible 90-minute adaptation of Shakespeare's A Midsummer Night's Dream. Adapted by Russell T. Davies, Doctor Who, Cucumber, it is the truthful version of the play, the original words, the original Shakespeare. Warm and funny, it'll have as much attitude and invention as any theatrical interpretation. A Midsummer Night's Dream is a much-loved comedy by William Shakespeare set in the tyrannical court of Athens and the magical forest around the city. The single drama will be for everyone, children who can laugh at Bottom and his mechanicals and marvel at the fairy's awesome powers, for adults who know that those broken hearts and star-crossed lovers all too well, for whole families united in front of the television to enjoy the play's dazzling world of danger, jokes, scares, poetry, thrills, and fun." They are looking to, production will be filming in Rolf Lock, Cardiff for transmission in 2016 as part of BBC's Shakespeare season.
It would be amazing if they brought in Dean Kelly to introduce it or narrate it. I don't know if there's a narrator or not, but to have some sort of role in the production. For those not familiar with the name, that's the actor that played Shakespeare in Doctor Who.
Right.
Well, considering that was a Russell T. Davies production, it would not surprise me if they needed Shakespeare for like an intro or an outro, they would get him.
As I recall, he did a very competent Shakespeare, so yeah.
A very interesting version of Shakespeare. And our last piece of news. In apparently what is to be a kind of a star-crossed drama, Karen Gillan is joining Tom Hanks, who people should know for being Tom Hanks. I mean, do I really need to list who he's from? And Emma Watson, who everybody remembers from Harry Potter as Hermione Granger. And John Boyega. Who the heck is John Boyega?
I've heard the name. Let me look it up. While I'm doing so, I want to point out only the Radio Times would put Amelia Pond above Hermione Granger.
I'm actually surprised by that, but...
Let's see here.
Oh, he's going to be in the upcoming Star Wars.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, that's where I know the name from.
So, and that is going to be a new science fiction... cyberspace drama.
He was the one that recently appeared in the trailer holding a lightsaber, isn't he?
Yes.
The Circle is a film based around a group of internet users who decide to link their personal emails, banking, and social media usage with their universal operating systems, only for things to go wrong. So it sounds essentially one of those fear the technology
bits.
Yeah.
Meh.
Is this going to be a film? Yes, it's a film. So it is. This is a theatrical release, so it's not going to be a series or anything. Karen Gillian's character Annie is described as a warm, goofy, old money, confident, and fiercely intelligent member of the circle. Of course, since they're talking about Karen Gillian, they're not talking about who the others are playing. And it is an adaptation of a Dave Eggers novel. And John Boyega is going to be the lead character in it. And that is going to be released sometime in 2016. All right. And that's the news.
That's the news as it is fit to print.
Yes.
Yes.
Good. Good.
Use your anger. So that brings us around to talking about the main event then, I guess.
Unless we have a little bit of time, considering once again our 5-minute summary is going to be about a minute plus.
Challenge student.
I started classes this week and I just blew about $300 on mostly art supplies because I was foolish enough to take 2 art general gen ed classes in one semester.
Try being an art major.
Yeah.
$1,500 for all that money goes.
The thing is, you save a little on textbooks, but since you can't buy art supplies used the same way that you can textbooks, it doesn't actually save money.
Mm-hmm.
Nope.
Yep. In other news, I finished a short story I've been working on for about 5 years now, I think.
Nice.
Maybe 4.
Do we get to read it?
Yeah, it's on Mystic Tales on WordPress. MYSTIKKTALES. It's called The Way to Kamas. So, it's based on a D&D campaign that I was in, or a character I created for that, so, yeah. It was supposed to be finished in about 5 weeks, but I got lazy.
Things happen.
Yeah.
RomeoMoon.wordpress.com.
Yeah, well, you know, you don't have, I've been writing the same fiction for a decade yet, and I do, so. Albeit mine's a little more than a short story.
Yeah, yours got overly complicated, then you just keep getting confused as to what you were doing again.
It didn't help that Moffitt changed the plot on him.
More like I had to keep rewriting to adapt. I really preferred writing under Davies because Davies would do a plot reveal and I'd go, that's going to make this so much easier. And then Moffitt does a plot twist and I go, oh god damn it. More thoughts for bringing back Davies.
You wish.
Well, hey, he's had a few years in America now. He's probably suntanned from being in California. But he's back at the BBC now and, you know, might actually be doing some, they could always lure him back. You never know.
Davies, come here, please. Please rewrite the script for us, please.
I think I remember reading something, about Moffitt talking about the next or wasn't that something that was we were talking about in Skype?
There had been an article where Moffitt was saying whoever the next showrunner is, they'd be brilliant, and people were talking junk, and so I had to be to reply in kind.
That really sounds, though, that that really gives a sound of Moffat really is giving some serious thought about standing down.
He can act on it any time.
Because, you know, up till now, he's not really said anything about there being a next showrunner.
I mean, every so often it's been brought up. I'm kind of wondering if they've just been stalling for a little while to look for one.
I'm thinking that's the major issue, is that they've had problems finding someone. Because, of course, Moffat had been fond of Gaddis as his successor, but Gaddis's outings and writing has been a bit lackluster.
At best.
That, yeah. And they'd probably have to discontinue Sherlock, and there'd be lynchings.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, granted, it's not like Sherlock puts out a lot of episodes, but still.
And other than that, there's nobody in the Doctor Who writing pool that has any, you know, quality showrunning talent that we've seen.
But again, none of them have really been given the chance, though, either. So we can't really say for sure either.
Yes, but what I'm saying is that there's no writers that really stand out as being outstanding.
I do feel that if you take Nick Briggs and you give him some quality directors, that within a year or two, he could grow into a really good showrunner once he has, you know, that year or two of leaning on directors for the visual experience under his belt. But I tend to enjoy his Big Finish stories personally, so that's part of why I say that.
Mm. But if you remember, when Russell T. Davies was showrunner, we always looked forward to whatever Stephen Moffat was coming out with that season. We were just like, oh yeah, it's going to be a Stephen Moffat episode, so it's going to be a good one.
Yeah, but now as him with showrunner, he's been hurrying everything way too fast and shoveling stuff half-finished.
Not the point, Matt. The point is that there has been nobody under Moffat that, except for the two episodes written by, what's his name?
Neil Gaiman.
Neil Gaiman, thank you. That we're saying, oh, look, it's a Neil Gaiman that written episode. Oh, that's going to be a good one. That's the only person that we've said that to, and we know Neil Gaiman's not going to want to be a showrunner. He doesn't like doing it.
But I would also argue that it's hard to tell writers apart when Moffat keeps editing things, possibly for the worst.
We can't ask Terry Pratchett to do it.
Or ignoring them completely.
Yeah.
Because that's Moffat's other issue. He's either editing things to add his own little pieces and ignoring the rest of the script regardless of how bad it is.
Does Joss Whedon have a British cousin?
No, unfortunately. I still would love to see Doctor Who.
Does
J.J. Abrams have a British
Peter
cousin?
Peter Capaldi has run One Rewards behind the camera. When the 13th Doctor takes over, Capaldi can take over as showrunner.
It would have to wait until then, Bill, because I would not want to see one person being writer, showrunner,
yeah.
Head writer, script editor, and lead actor.
Not for a series, maybe for a movie. And even then, only a very rare individual can do it.
Because that's a recipe for dying. And I'm not talking, I am not talking, you know, social death or professional death. I'm talking, oh my God, he's just had a heart attack, he's in the hospital. Because, you know, if you already look at the showrunners, they burn out pretty hard because of all the work.
Mm-hmm.
And the doctors are always running their asses off, too.
And they burn out after about 3 years. Unless your name happens to be Tom Baker. Then it takes 7. But, generally speaking, it's very hard work being either the head writer or the head actor in Doctor Who. I would not want to step into both roles simultaneously.
And it's worth noting that both the longest-running Doctor and the longest-running producer both tried to step down and were told no at some point during their careers.
Well, mind you, with the producer, he wanted to step down, but was basically told no because the response was, you broke it, you need to fix it before you leave.
And never fixed it.
Tom, actually, I'm not sure he wanted to leave.
I think it was the first time they changed producers under him, if I remember the story correctly. Basically, they changed the direction, and he was like, now's my time to go. And they're like, no, you're too much a part of the show. We need to keep you on.
And then he had fun for a few more years, and then JNT came along.
I think that was when Hinchcliffe left.
That would have been then the second time the producers changed. Because wasn't he still under Letts for like the first few episodes?
Technically, maybe.
Letts was basically as a holdover from the Third Doctor era. But he only produced Robot of Baker's episodes.
So it was Letts to Hinchcliffe then?
Yeah.
Okay. But
then
yeah,
it was Williams and then Turner.
Because yeah, he had a good run under Williams. He didn't think he would, but Williams was just like, yeah, you do your own thing.
And sure, Douglas Adams helped with that when he came on.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But then, yeah, Baker was not fond of JNT and was used to basically being showrunner. Even though he wasn't head writer, he was, you know.
That's what happened when you're the star for 6 years.
Yeah. But, yeah, somebody needs, I mean, you know, if Moffat's talking about who, you know, the next showrunner will be brilliant no matter who it is, that means he's thinking about bowing out. Which is kind of a finally in my book. I wouldn't mind him coming back to write an episode once a year or once every other year. But, honestly, he's not doing that great a job.
As long as they're not Angels every time.
Wait, Angels or Riversong or Paternoster, because...
Next episode he writes can be a Vashti Narada episode edited by somebody else.
As long as whoever follows up is good at looking at somebody else's script and going, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong, go back and fix these. Because that's the one main thing you need to do as a showrunner. You need to make sure that the people under you are producing quality. And that's the one thing that Moffat hasn't done because, oh my God, Journey to the Center of the TARDIS.
Uh-huh. No quality
control.
Let it go,
man. Let it go.
I will not let it go while Stephen Moffat is still running because there's no excuse for Journey.
By the way, you should see what the stream is doing right now.
Separate ways.
Why, what's that, Matt?
Got a very big picture of Steven Moffat's face with just these dead eyes.
There's no excuse for a lot of the lackluster editing. Steven Moffat, if he has time to do it, has great job as a writer. He has written some great things. The 11th Hour, Bells of St. John, Day of the Doctor, and then the finale for the last season are great episodes. They're some of our best episodes that we've reviewed. But at the same time, you have to look at what everyone else is writing and go, no, make this a little better or fix it yourself. And Moffat, since he writes so many episodes, doesn't have time to fix it himself. Moffat would be a lot better producer if he had a separate script editor, like they did in like the 80s. And this, by the way, is the reason they did this in the 80s and the 70s. And I think the 60s. Is because it's too much for one person to chew. If you're not Joss Whedon or Russell T. Davies, it's too much for one person to chew.
That's because they're both crazy men.
No, they both kind of graduated from the same school of creating. All right, so let's get on to the 5-minute challenge.
So I can probably put away the Russell, okay. Or not the Russell, the Steven.
Why do you keep calling him Russell?
I don't know why I keep calling him Russell today. My brain just hemorrhages names wrong.
All showrunners look alike to you?
No! You know my dyslexia. Apparently my dyslexia wants to screw with Moffat and... just... The mental image is right, but the names keep mixing for no damn discernible reason.
Maybe you keep thinking of rustling reeds.
I have no idea where that came from.
There's a joke on his name, Russell. Yeah, Russell? Rustling reeds?
Yeah, I know. It was a bit of a stretch, though. If there had been someone else we were talking about named Reed, might have helped. All right, so 5-minute challenge. Get the stopwatch up, although you probably are not going to need it. This is not going to take long. As it's not going to take long, there is no sponsor.
10-second challenge.
It is not going to be 10 salons because I have to introduce the opening bit.
Don't you mean 10 rels?
10 salons, did you say?
What? Yeah, that suddenly got really skewed.
Don't you mean 10 rels?
No. Nobody really knows what a rel is, except it's more or less a second.
From what I hear, there are 50 rels in a minute.
Yeah.
Except Davros once used rels as if they were minutes. So
yeah.
That just made it all the more confusing.
It's like if you're a fan of the old Battlestar Galactica series. Not the one that came out in the 2000s, the original 1970s one. They would use centons and microns, but they used them in ways that you never really got a proper listing for what their length was.
Usually when they're counting down rels for like an explosion, it's pretty much the equivalent of a second.
Yes, I know that, but then they've also been used wrong. It's a undetermined length of time. And I'll talk about rels a little later, actually, because...
Maybe it's like Han Solo's parsecs.
Let's not even go there.
Do I need to bring back the Moffat face with his dead eyes just to keep waiting for you people?
I just... like...
Don't you mean
it's
erase
the ship
your head?
That made the Kessel run in less than 12 parsecs. Wow. If I knew what that was... if I understood that, I'd be impressed.
Considering a parsec is a measurement of distance, not a measurement
of time. It's the amount of distance away from the black hole cluster in the Maw.
Anyway, stopwatch, you ready, Matt?
Yes.
All right, give me a countdown.
3, 2, 1, go.
We open the story with a very young Bernard Cribbins walking the beat as a policeman. He is looking around, and he is unfortunately attacked by the getaway car driver of a jewel heist, who tends to apparently get out of their jewelry heist by blowing up the building. They, while Cribbins is disabled, get into their car and drive away, shortly pursued by Cribbins, who throws his nightstick at them. Since that did absolutely nothing, Cribbins sees a nearby police box and walks in. Much to his surprise, it's a lot bigger on the inside than he expected. It is, in fact, TARDIS, run by Doctor Who, with his granddaughter Susan and his niece. What was her name? Linda?
I can't even remember.
Louise.
Louise.
He promptly collapses unconscious, and before he wakes up, Doctor Who has started the TARDIS and has gotten away. When he comes to, he discovers they are not in 1965, but are in fact in 2150. Not believing the story, he opens the door and walks out. For the rest of the summary, you can look on our April 15th episode, Dalek Invasion of Earth, episode 102. End.
That was pause it. That was 1:27 when you stopped.
Well, it was Bernard Crippen, so it took a little longer than last week.
Mm-hmm. Right, said Fred.
You left out the scene that I'm going to be referring to later on.
Oh,
you mean the end?
Yeah.
We're going to be talking about the ending.
Okay.
Matter of fact, funny thing is that I also recently had the exact same problem with Ghost Rider recently, but that's another story.
Yeah, let's go on to our likes and dislikes. Starting with what you liked about this show overall. Starting with Matt.
I like that we threw money at the design again, a lot for this one. We had bigger sets than even last time. We had some more Dalek models. They actually re-upped the models from the previous movie. And we also completely refleshed the design for the Robo-Men, which actually works pretty well, all considering.
All right. Yeah, I actually liked these Robo-Men a lot better than I liked the ones from the original series.
Yeah, the original series, they just had weird little big-headed devices on them. These guys looked like they were a proper organized unit.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure how I feel about their costumes. They seem a little...
Oh, basic. I love the costumes!
The costumes are fantastic. They were great for 60s.
Yeah.
I especially liked the theme song that went with them as they walked around. That was quite a I was like, okay, that's kind of awesome this time. But yeah, the production value on this was very nice. The Dalek ship was nice.
Mm-hmm.
The
models were nice. They had a lot of miniatures and models and stuff that they used that were really well done.
And they took the time to hire actual Dalek voices.
They hired actual Dalek voices. They actually had even more explosions than ever before. That usually is a sign of money right there for a for any kind of filming. Doctor Who wouldn't get that kind of explosions until they had Tom Baker on.
Only if they blow up their own property. If they blow up somebody else's property, no budget needed.
Of course, the bright part of the one of the reasons that they had this is because they could do a lot of location shooting. As opposed to having to make big matte paintings for Skaro. All their close-up shots could be done.
So.
That's true, they could travel to London. They couldn't travel to...
They still had to matte painting. They still had to matte paint for bombed-out London.
Yeah.
But any close-up shots could have been done. You know, location shots.
Mm-hmm.
They did not have quite as many epic location shots as the original serial did, though. The Daleks crossing that bridge is still one of the most epic.
Yeah, I'm surprised they didn't try to get some of that back, but...
Yeah, they didn't have the Dalek rising from the Thames, did they?
Yes, they did.
They did?
Yeah.
Yeah, they definitely had the water.
They did it a little differently, and it was overdone by cheesy 60s action music.
Yeah, all of a sudden the Doctor and Cribbins look down from the UFO to see that they're surrounded by Robo-Men, try to back away, and all of a sudden you see one of the blue Daleks quickly rise out of the water right in front of them as they're trying to run away.
Mm-hmm. All right, so Tim, what did you like overall?
Overall, I really liked the fact that this movie had sort of a... early 50s, 60s live-action Disney movie feel.
Yeah.
It sort of like felt like the Doctor Who, Mary Poppins.
They're more or less around the same decade, weren't they?
Yeah, more or less.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but
so it's pretty high end for British production.
It sort of had that sort that tone.
Mm-hmm.
Which made me feel all nostalgic. Yes?
Yeah, it was... Well, didn't we talk last week about Disney, about the concept of Disney's Doctor Who?
A little bit, yeah. Yeah, we did that on air last time.
But yeah, this is the same era.
So the same era, and it actually, speaking of which, it kind of feels like what would Disney do if they were allowed the property and went a little more gutsy than they normally would have back in the 60s.
Yeah, except for less musical numbers.
Yes, less music. Like I said, more gutsy, because less musical numbers, a little more on-screen violence.
I forget, does Disney allow the grandparents to live? Do they only kill the parents?
Depends. Depends upon the plot, mostly.
They have little Susie wandering around London, lost by herself.
I'm imagining the musical number, I'm the Doctor and I'm Here to Save You. Done in that Disney cheese.
How about a villainous number where the Daleks are marching up and down the streets like they did in the original episodes, and you got like a musical number where they're chanting about how they're trying to find and destroy the humans?
Daleks do not sing. Daleks do not sing.
They do in a Disney number.
Okay, Bill, what would you like for all?
I'm going to say I like that they actually attempted to keep continuity so much, a bit, well, I'm not going to say so much, but better than the original Terry Nation did. They at least acknowledged that the original Daleks story happened and tried to come up with a reason as to how this could exist in the same universe as that. That's more than Terry Nation ever tried, so I'm giving that a thumbs up.
I thought that was brought up in the original Dalek Invasion of Earth.
Mentioned the fact that they could travel out, you know, differently because of the things on their back, but they had no idea, no attempt to reconcile the origins or when the first story took place in comparison to this or anything like that in the original.
I thought they had. I thought when they first saw Daleks at the beginning of episode 2 of Dalek Invasion of Earth, Ian goes, "Daleks, how can they be here?" And answer's different depending on whether you're reading the episode or reading the book. Because I believe he said, "Well, you've got to remember, that happened in the far future. So now we have to go through the entire history of the Daleks." And then The book gives the answer, well, that was one city. There is no saying there might have been other cities or worlds that the Daleks ruled.
Which is also very true.
Yeah. So I'm pretty sure that was actually addressed in both the serial and the novelization, Bill. Because I knew that answer and that response, and I had never seen this before we watched it on Thursday before GeekCon.
Mm-hmm.
It is literally like a 1 minute line piece of dialogue, and that's all they ever deal with it with. And it's only between the Doctor and Ian. It either happens right at the beginning of 2 or right after they get captured and are on the spaceship.
I think it's just somehow you managed to either miss it or forget about it.
Maybe. I mean, I know I've seen a lot talked about the fact that they managed to screw up Dalek continuity in their second appearance as well, so that might have influenced my memory as well.
Oh, I would also add, as I was mentioning earlier, with the upgrades visually, with sets and so forth, they also fixed the Dalek bumps.
Yeah, the main issue with Dalek continuity, Bill, is the fact that the whole thing about the Daleks and the war and everything was supposed to have happened in the far, far future, and at this point, Daleks weren't supposed to have time travel. So how are they showing up at, you know, 2060 or whatever the original serial was?
Well, that's simple. It's actually part of their original continuity line.
No.
And we don't have any clue when the first story happened.
It is the far, far future, as stated in the Daleks. The Doctor actually says
right,
that
killing them in their future, yeah, killing them in their future would not interfere with this.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I guess it depends on your definition of the far, far future.
Yeah, it still doesn't mess with this doesn't mess with continuity at all. I don't see what people have a problem with, to be honest. Mm-hmm. Because we don't know where to meet.
Anyway, Aaron, what do you like about this serial?
I liked how they altered some of the characters. Like, Susan has been a child since, like, the first movie, but I also kind of liked how they altered, the smuggler. They changed him, kind of how he was dressed. His demeanor was a little more stiff and, you know, unapproachable. You know, he was keeping everyone at a distance more.
Well, he did in the original, too, but he did it a lot more sarcastically.
Yeah. Yeah, this one, he was a little more, I don't know, a little more interesting, I guess. What else? And, of course, Bernard Crimmins, I don't know. I like the characters a lot more in this than in the serial. Everyone seemed to be kind of a little bit more engaged with each other.
Yeah. Also, I would say that Bernard Cribbins, compared to the previous Ian Chesterton that we had, was a much better replacement for Ian.
Yes.
Yeah.
He was actually semi-competent.
Yes. Bernard Cribbins as Tom played a better Ian than whoever the guy that played Ian was in Doctor Who and the Daleks.
Yeah, so I actually do really like having Susan as a kid in this, because it enhances the danger around her, because are they actually going to, they're probably not going to kill a kid on screen, but we don't really know that.
Yeah. And they're probably not going to drop her off to marry a guy that she met in the future.
Yeah.
Yeah.
At least not right now.
Yeah, probably not anyway.
Yeah, that's actually kind of related to what I really liked about this. And that is the fact that they changed a hell of a lot more from the original serial than the first movie did.
Mm-hmm.
The first movie pretty much was almost a summary of the original serial. I mean, yes, it was cut back to, you know, an hour and a half or whatever that first movie was from its original length. But they didn't cut much. And all the characters did functionally the same thing, except Ian, who played a stumbling blunderbuss boob. In this one, even though the character roles are closer to their original counterparts, they're not always in the same situation. The character of Susan winds up taking more of Barbara's role in the original. Being with the member of the Resistance as they're fleeing in a vehicle up the road to the to Bedfordshire.
Which also in itself was a fantastic scene.
Barbara winds up on the flying saucer with Ian, whereas there was another character that had that role in the original, who was out there to Bedfordshire to look for his cousin, I believe.
Something like that,
or his brother-in-law,
yeah.
Something like that. Those slight changes, because there was only one major change in the first movie, and that was the fate of the cowardly Thal in the caves. And that was really only done so they didn't have to, you know, add another cast member to replace him when he died. It was kind of a budgeting reason.
Mm-hmm.
Here, it changed enough that you never were quite sure what was going to happen next. Whether it would follow the original storyline or not. And the resolution actually succeeded where their attempt to do so in the original serial failed. Which was kind of cool. It was kind of, I don't know, it made it less predictable and more enjoyable to me.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So, generally, that's what we liked. What didn't you like, Matt?
Oh. Something I didn't like. I think it still lagged in places. There's still little pockets of, really useless time wasters and stuff here and there, but generally the movie was at least consistent enough to try and get rid of as much of that as possible. but there still seems to be little fragments of wasted time and useless threads that never go anywhere, but they were severely cut back compared to how much you had to pad out for a serial. Less running around, but there's still plenty of people trying to find one another and wasting time trying to even do that. Here and there. Particularly on the ship, as I recall, it took a while for the two to meet up with each other on the ship.
And, I like those scenes.
But I will admit that, despite the fact that they were fluff, Bernard Cribbins did put on a nice little show where he tried to be a Robo-Man for a little bit.
Mm-hmm. With a lot of kind of fish-out-of-water humor, which is really what Ian should have been having in the first serial.
Mm-hmm.
Not pratfalls.
Yeah. But that's pretty much my little nitpick. It's not like a huge thing, it's just that it's still kind of here, but it's not as bad as it used to be.
Okay, Tim, how about you?
In general, I felt that the sense of danger wasn't very threatening throughout this movie.
Mm.
I felt like there was no real urgency. Despite the fact that Earth has been invaded by soulless killing machines who hate everything, it felt more like a Sunday picnic.
Mm, and that's what you felt. I felt, but go on.
I might have been disarmed by the charm and wit of Bernard Cribbins, but. I felt the original serial gave had much more suspense.
Well, the music didn't help there.
Yeah, that probably didn't help.
It was kind of
that was going to be my point was the music. Yeah,
I will agree that at many we'll combine yours here then. Yeah, I will agree that the music was. In many parts, a failure. The only one I actually liked was the March of the Robo-Men.
Feels like it should, like they're going for a silent movie and or comedy.
No,
and then remember that it's neither.
No, it was the fact that they used action music in place of dramatic tension music.
Mm-hmm.
So that the scenes that should have been dramatic tension. Like the Dalek coming out of the river, instead of having, you know, this low menacing music, you had zany action music.
Well, that was a problem of the 60s anyway.
Yes, I know, but that was kind of what was hurting it, because the serials actually did it right, where you would, you know, what little music there was dramatic tension music. And instead you come off like, those wacky Daleks. So, since we kind of took builds there, anybody else notice that, anybody else cannot look at Bernard Cribbins playing Tom and go, hey, look, it's Wilfred Mott, the early years.
Yes.
Yeah.
That was their plan all along.
Because
I kind of wish it was the same character, actually.
Yeah. If they had not named him Wilf and had instead named him Tom, and bet they didn't because they probably did not have the rights to the AARP.
Do you realize what that would do to universal continuity?
Yes. It would implode in on itself in the world's biggest timey-wimey ball ever.
No, it's just an alternate universe.
But if it was the same guy instead?
No, it was just an alternate version of that same guy. It's Tom, but it's in a different universe.
Yes, but imagine the fact that if you then had Donna Noble talking about the guy in the blue box. He's like, I seen that box.
you just have that slow, like, nerd outside talking about it, and then all of a sudden you just see Wilf slowly
pull away
from the telescope and go.
He was the first one to know that there were aliens coming to the Earth, and his family didn't listen to anything he said anyway.
Yeah.
He watched the doctor teleport away from him even before Donna ever started traveling with him. So
Yeah, but no, I see that box. I mean, just watching continuity unfold in on itself, whimpering. Right. Especially later on when you get to Journey's End, where the Daleks are invading, and you just see Wilf look at them going, oh no, not again.
Mm-hmm.
Or at this pace, it would be Tom.
Well, maybe that's why he knew to shoot the eye stalks with paint.
Too bad the new models are updated.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm glad they didn't do that in a way, because yes, that would take roll continuity in on itself and take them whimpering away. It would just.
But the in references.
The in references are one thing, but you know how I feel about continuity, Matt.
Well, you do realize time has been changed so many times since the original story happened.
Yes, but at the same time, you don't want to try to coincide there being two separate versions of the Dalek invasion of Earth.
I mean, granted, this one is set later, and there were supposed to be like 5 Dalek occupations of Earth. But the problem is, it's the exact same plot as the first Dalek invasion of Earth.
So you think the Daleks
would
have learned.
Really awkward, yeah.
They think the Daleks would have learned it, not
awkward.
To mention another new guy who's saying that he's the doctor, would also
like,
turn a few Dalek heads.
It's like Wile E. Coyote constantly trying to get the Roadrunner. Only with Daleks.
How many of those old Roadrunner cartoons actually ended with Wile E. Coyote dying?
None of them. Although there was one episode where Wile E. Coyote did catch a Roadrunner, but he was also extremely diminished in size.
Yeah.
No, I was
pretty
sure. How
many Dalek serials have we seen where the Daleks have died?
All of them.
No, I was just saying that I would swear one of those ended with him going up to heaven strumming a harp.
Now I'm thinking of Dalek Angel.
I'm picturing the Dalek chasing, like, the 10th or 11th Doctor, and he comes to a wall and draws a tunnel on it and runs through it with Time Lord technology, and the Daleks crash into it and are destroyed.
No, I'm remembering.
It's Time Lord paint. It's bigger on
no,
the inside.
No, I'm remembering this episode of Farscape where they all became cartoons.
Mm.
I'm imagining that being applied to Doctor Who. Just some episode where you've got the chase 2 going on, only they go through some freaking warp in space and wind up in a universe where they're all tunified.
Next time, Doctor. Next time.
I did not say they turned into Dr. Claw, Matt.
that was a bonus.
How could a Dalek pet a cat?
Davros could pet a cat with his one hand.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, if
any
character could be Dr. Claw, it would be Davros. Okay, so we were up to Aaron. What didn't you like?
Oh, damn, I thought you'd forgotten me.
Bad things.
What I didn't like, I think having this serial in color actually kind of detracted from the tension. I think having it in black and white played it more as played it up more as a horror, possibly a horror theme, and a thriller. On top of everything, so. I was actually just thinking of that, so I was like, you know, this is really bright and colorful, and even if we're a post-apocalyptic story.
Well, again, 60s.
Yeah, I know.
Kamen Rider came out in the 70s, and it was a bleak-ass hell story, but it was all bright and colors.
Well, yeah, but it's also kind of the
true,
reason
but
why.
This is back in the days when studios had the balls to make a black and white movie. When the story called for it.
Yeah.
Yeah, but Britain just wanted to show that they were flashy.
I do kind of wonder what this would have looked like if it were in black and white.
We could do that.
Yeah, we can do that. We did
I
it with
make
Captain
it possible.
America.
I can make it possible without having to rely on a faulty projector. Stories,
so it's,
references.
It's just an idea, you know. It's the whole black and white versus color film, you know. There's a lot of, I don't know how dark the shadows would be, but, you know, you might have to deepen the shadows.
Oh, I can work that. I can
part
work
of the issue
shadows.
At the same time was that Britain had just gotten a hold of color technology.
Yeah, like I was saying, Britain wanted to be really flashy.
It was still new and shiny to them.
Yeah,
it's
they wanted
the
everything flashy.
It's swirly colors of the beginning of the movie.
Hence also
filmed
why
in Technicolor.
Hence why our lead female had bright yellow boots.
Let's watch paint swirl down a drain.
Okay.
That's time for chicks.
What I didn't like was the lack of, and I mentioned this earlier, the lack of relevant location shooting. The lack of being able to actually get more of the feel of this was London instead of this was any town UK.
Yeah, they could have really used that Dalek montage.
Not just over the bridge. I mean, you know, they had some budget. Could you imagine Daleks in Trafalgar Square right next to a broken version of the statue?
Yeah.
Or better yet, have like a busted Big Ben in some of those matte paintings in the background or something.
Mm-hmm.
Anything.
Yes. Instead, there, other than the power center, which factored in very big in the serial originally, there was no real reference to any serious location in London. It just kind of fell apart. It lost a bit of the oh my god. It's the same thing that makes Escape from New York and Escape from L.A. Such awesome movies is if you've ever been to New York or L.A. and you're watching these movies, you actually recognize some of the locations.
Mm-hmm.
Which is something they failed at when Jason took what he thought was Manhattan, but was really Toronto.
Well, yeah. Other than the fact that he was walking down Times Square at one point, but yeah.
Yes.
That was about the only place where you could actually identify New York. Or was it Times Square? Yeah.
I don't know. For me, it was L.A., because I've been to L.A., a lot, so I was looking at locations going, holy shit, I know that location. The fact that they hang glided off the Hollywood sign.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And had the final shootout scene in the Magic Kingdom by the sea, aka Disneyland, amused the hell out of me. But, yeah, here there's not enough relevant locations. All right, scenes that you liked.
Oh. So it goes to me first, of course. So I have to pick I have to pick one of my babies. I have to say the one that seems most memorable to me almost all the time is the attack on the Dalek ship.
Okay.
Just lots of action, lots of manic stuff going on. Everything that you would want in a Dalek movie happening all at once. Explosions, fighting going on.
And there,
Robo-Men dying, Daleks exploding, being knocked over, and everything else.
There, the cheesy action music worked.
Yes.
Because it's cheesy action.
It absolutely.
It failed when it needed to be dramatic tension instead of cheesy action.
Again, I blame the 60s. But, yeah.
All right, Tim, how about you? Your favorite scene?
My favorite scene was the scene where Bernard Cribbins is disguised as a Roboman and he has to eat with the other Roboman.
Oh, God damn it, Tim.
You stole one of Randy's.
Yeah, that was
so
mine.
Matt takes mine and Tim takes Rand's?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Just the choreography of that scene.
Yeah.
And
It really was the best scene that Cribbins could show his comedic side. And like I said, it was all fish-out-of-water comedy.
Mm-hmm.
Which is exactly what you should be experiencing when you're chucked 200 years in the future. And really only have half a clue on what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Bill, so do you have a backup?
I'm going to say the scene in which the, I guess referring to him as the smuggler, the scene in which he tries to get out on top of everyone and ends up being blown up in the cabin.
Oh,
I
yeah.
found that funny all the way from, you know, oh, Daleks around us. I'm sorry about this. Oh, don't apologize. I was expecting you to betray me. And then you come with us too. No, I'm going to close this wooden door because wood is the only thing you fear, right?
I don't think this is signs. Kaboom.
I just like how miraculously...
They're not using sonic screwdrivers.
I just like how miraculously steam starts a fire.
Well,
more to the point, CO2, because those were fire extinguishers inside the Daleks.
Oh, yeah, a fire extinguisher can start a fire. An explosion, nonetheless.
By the way, did we ever cover the fact that that was originally the intent for what the Daleks should be firing in the TV show?
No, I liked what they did in the TV show better, though.
Yes, yeah. I have to admit that the actual laser beam effects were better. But that was actually the original intent, was to have them actually shoot something out of their laser pistols like that. And admittedly, while it looks, in some places it works, in places like where things are supposed to catch on fire, it doesn't, kinda.
Well, it would if they had also had that inverted effect that they did in the TV show when the Dalek stuff went off, where they inverted the color palette, etc.
Right.
To let you know that there was another effect going on. But just seeing them just shoot out the jets of CO2 is nowhere near as awe-inspiring.
And that's part of the whole thing about the Daleks not feeling as threatening. In this movie and the previous one, it just doesn't feel quite as dangerous with fire extinguisher arms.
All right. So whose was that?
That was Bill. Bill's.
Yeah, that
right.
Was
mine. So right. Aaron.
Aaron.
I like the whole magnetism screwing up the Dalek scene, particularly the one with the Daleks shooting down the hallway. It's just like, what the hell is wrong with that thing? And then you realize, oh yeah, the magnetism is messing up with the Daleks, and it's, you know, causing them to go kind of crazy. It was just kind of funny to see it just smash through the wall like that. Kind of like a Roadrunner cartoon.
All right. Yeah, that was actually a fairly good scene.
Mm-hmm.
Really seeing Daleks do stuff they'd never seen before. Magnetism was never a major issue in the original one, if I recall.
Mm-hmm.
So that was kind of a new way of defeating them.
Massive magnetism, because they had mostly metal bodies after.
Mm-hmm.
And not only just the one that went through the wall, but also the one that went into the mine shaft and got crushed and just kind of melted against the wall because it was too hard.
Yep, and that brings me to the only scene where Daleks would have a disadvantage. We are the Daleks, exterminate. I am Magneto.
Mm. What is a Magneto?
Let me show you. Yeah. The only way that the Daleks would fear one person that's not the Doctor
would be a Magneto, because yeah, he could just fling them around like little toys.
Or
unless it's the Magneto from Menace of Magneto.
Or, you know, just expand his hand and watch all the parts of the Dalek just fly in different directions simultaneously, leaving the inner.
I was kind of thinking like a legion of Daleks condensed into like a six pack.
That could be too.
Popping fresh Daleks, just open the top.
What that would do against the Sentai plastic Daleks, I don't know. Maybe that's what they were built to combat.
We are no longer stopped by magnetism.
Alright, so I think my favorite scene is where you first see the flying saucer, because that was especially for that era, that was one hell of a nice looking flying saucer.
Yeah.
It actually beat the first model for the USS Enterprise from Star Trek, which would appear later that year.
Mm-hmm.
Because it had moving parts.
Yeah. It was detailed and it was moving, so
yes.
Yeah, eat it.
Yeah, that was quite impressive.
And
if I recall correctly, it was spinning in two different directions on the top, too.
Spinning in two different directions, was lit up from the inside, and also looked to be made of at least plastic. Because I see a sheen on that thing.
Mm-hmm.
And that it was also used as a model to destroy the entire mine, which they also tried to at least semi-recreate in person as well, with a huge explosion.
Yeah, that was a very nice model.
Mm-hmm.
So, scene you didn't like. Matt.
Do we want to cover the elephant in the room this early? Because I know at least two of us have an issue.
Elephant to cover?
I think Bill might kill you because I think he called dibs.
Because I know at least three of us have an issue with the elephant in the room. I will wait until the elephant in the room, I guess. So let Tim and Aaron go first.
All right, Tim, what do you got?
I really didn't like the scene where the doctor and Bernard Cribbins fail to see the message that Susan left.
Yeah, I remember that was a bit jarring for us too the first time.
Yeah, I was just that just seemed to be a bit forced.
Yeah, and not only that, but the fact that they go out of the way to say, Susan probably left a message, but I don't see it. So it's like they're bringing attention to the fact that they're failing to see the message. It just makes it even worse.
Well, the fact that Susan wrote it on the door that they enter and exit from was also not the brightest idea either.
And I could have sworn I saw moments where the message would have been visible in their peripheral vision. Or
I remember that too, yeah.
Yeah, it was kind of a contrived scene.
Mm-hmm.
So, Aaron, what do you got?
The professor dying under a ton of rubble.
Oh.
I kind of liked it better where he was just, like, facing them out. I liked it better in the serial how he died. I mean, I understand why they kind of killed him off. I mean, obviously, it's very hard to film around a man trying to survive the apocalypse in a wheelchair. It's not a very realistic, you know, notion what with the everyone's feelings. Well, it's not a very realistic notion on that, but it could happen, I guess. But like on his own and everything like that, yeah. But there's also, I don't know, I just felt that it was a lot more, he had
poignant.
A lot more power, poignant, yeah. It was a lot more powerful, it was a more powerful moment. Him just staring them down, it was the whole, you know, Western, you know.
And
if you're going to take me down, I'll take you with me kind of deal with
exactly.
The original. Whereas this one was just me, my stupid.
It's just, it just blew up a building on top of me. Oh, God!
Yeah, and, you know, he was doing it, and they didn't have time to explain why he was doing it, where they did in the serial, where he had, you know, reformulated his bombs, because they didn't work so well in the raid, and he was basically proving to them that it worked.
Yeah, it was basically, he was dying for his idea. He had believed and invested so much of his time and his life in trying to, you know, find a way to defeat the Daleks, and he had, you know, researched the Dalekanium bomb and everything, and it was actually kind of cool, because I believe that was the first we heard about Dalekanium, wasn't it?
Yes, it was.
Technically, yes.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it was a big moment in that, and even though he, you know, he didn't really survive that long into the serial, I don't think. He died in the second episode, didn't he?
Second episode.
Yeah, somewhere in there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But still.
Made halfway, either way.
It was done a lot better in the serial, and I was kind of disappointed to see how he died in this. It was kind of a pointless death, almost.
All right. So now we're moving on to the elephant in the room, as it was.
Yes.
Matt, Bill.
The ending of the episode.
The scene in which the Doctor sends, I keep wanting to say Wilf, Tom, back a few minutes before he took off in order to prevent the jewel heist.
That caused him to take off with them in the first place.
Mm-hmm. Which
can
also,
somebody say paradox?
Well, not only that, but also he apparently his existence there wipes out his previous existence of ever being there in the first place.
Yes,
maybe it's an alternate universe where he wasn't there.
That makes no sense.
I've seen time travel stories like that, and they always seem weird
US
to me.
Going back in time
causes you to take over the body of the you that's supposed to be there, and the time-traveling you is
there. And I'll mention this again, because it's kind of a poignant thing, is that I had the exact same problem happen with a recent episode of Ghost Rider, where he went into the far distant past, then suddenly came back and had enough time to change what went wrong originally. But at least there it was actually freaking magic. This makes no sense.
Okay. So let
or
me.
Or maybe it is. Maybe he is Tom when he leaves. When he arrives, in order to prevent a paradox, he changes his name to Wilf.
Oh, God, Aaron.
Aaron,
I agree with Aaron.
If you weren't sleeping on the couch tonight, you would be now. Because that's the kind of stuff I want to kick Bill in the dick for suggesting. Anyway, so let me do a hypothetical rewrite for you here. Cut back to the opening scene, where you have instead of focusing on the guy in the car, you focus in on Tom walking down the street, looking in a store, you know, a cop on duty when he's hit by behind, but you never quite see his attacker, only that he runs back to the getaway car. And then the jewelers come out, the car takes off, Wilf pursuit, sees TARDIS, goes in, yada, yada, yada. Cut back to the end of the scene, where you see him take out the driver of the car, look over, see himself, have to knock himself out.
Gets hit by the Blinovich limitation effect.
Let's not even talk about that, Bill. And technically, he'd be hitting him on the head with a stick anyway, or truncheon, whatever.
Yeah, he wouldn't be directly touching himself. He'd hit himself over the head of a blunt instrument.
Blackjack, whatever, yes. Whatever he was hit with originally. Anyway. So, has to knock himself out. The guys from the jewelry store come out and get in the car, drive off. You briefly see him in pursuit. And then the guys go to turn around, and he knocks both of them out.
And then he continues to laugh to himself, just like he did in the original ending of this movie, as he's driving off.
Thinking of himself as, Detective Inspector OBE. Mm-hmm. Would that have solved all your issues, Bill?
Well, it solved mine.
Maybe, although, I mean, I don't know how Doctor Who is compared to, changing your own timeline and such, and being willing to go back to that point.
Well, it's very easy. You see, he just drives home to his granddaughter, Susan, who's renamed Donna now, so.
Aaron! Do not make me come out there!
Matt. Oh. I think I accidentally left something on here. Just a moment. I'm in the middle of a podcast.
Sound muted.
Oops, I left TeamSpeak on by accident. Sorry about that. All of a sudden, the fourth voice came in. I'm like, wait a second.
All the problem, turning off your phone, all this, and...
And I forget about TeamSpeak.
No, I forgot to put TeamSpeak on vibrate.
Don't. All of a sudden, Art came in. Anyway.
Okay. So, you wouldn't think that would fix your problems with it, Bill?
It would fix most of them. I mean, him being willing to bring him back to a point where he could cause that sort of problem raises an eyebrow, but not as badly. Not as badly as actually
Stephen
causing
Moffat
such
would
a
love
paradox
it,
that would prevent him from showing up in the TARDIS.
Yeah, because that would Moffat would love it, because technically that would be a bootstrap paradox. Just saying.
Right.
Technically, yeah. But, yeah, that would fix pretty much all my problems, and to be honest, it still would have happened one way or the other. It's just that this version, he ends it with himself hitting himself, instead
yeah,
of the original
and
with the crook hitting him.
Filming the first scene so you never actually saw the driver meant that it technically could have been him in the first place.
Maybe.
That's the whole point of doing of filming it that way. Of it being him having to do that to himself was the big reveal. But that would have just been the interest. That would have been a more interesting way of doing it.
Mm-hmm.
So
that was our worst moment for three of us.
The one more scene that I did not like was how they did the escaping from the Dalek intelligence test for robotization.
Oh, yeah, that was just based purely on luck.
Yeah, it was based on luck instead of having an actual set way of solving the trap. It's just like, what do you have in your pockets?
Do you have a magnet? Because if
you have a magnet, you can
mess with things.
Basically, if you escape, you're intelligent enough.
Yeah. And it's purely based on what have you got in your pockets.
So basically, did you choose the right starting class?
Did you, you are trapped on an alien ship. You have one thing in your pocket. Did you choose the right items?
Did you remember your magnificent towel?
That kind of bothered me. All right, so let's go into final thoughts. Matt.
Overall, there are some things that feel like they're missing, and I will admit that there seems to be at least a minor loss of threat for the Daleks in this one. But I would still argue that it's still very much there. I think it's just a presence of mind for it, maybe? I don't know. But I think this is overall a much better attempt at a recreation and an upgrade to the shortened version of the same story than the original Doctor Who and the Daleks. This could have actually gone somewhere if they would have had the chance to, and if certain things didn't go the way they went. Sadly, Terry Nation decided to go elsewhere with Daleks, and it failed.
Actually, no, that's not what happened.
That's part of it. Also,
what happened was this movie bombed in the theaters.
Really? I don't think it was that bad, but okay.
They had a third movie planned that was going to be based off The Chase, but AARP elected not to make it because this movie did so poorly in the box office. I actually did research on this.
Hmm. Last I heard, they didn't really have a set reason why the third one didn't go off, or at least by then I wasn't paying enough attention, maybe. I don't know. But I do remember they were at least starting tests for the third one.
Maybe The Chase would have been better left alone.
Yeah,
I think The Chase would have been a lot better as a 60s movie rather than a Doctor Who serial.
Also, I would think that maybe gradually could bring the Daleks to a point where they could have done their own spin-offs would have been better, too. Could have covered more backstory.
Yeah, but at the same time, I mean, the Chase had enough of that zaniness.
I mean, if you do The Chase and you name it Abbott and Costello Meet the Daleks.
That'd be good.
Anyway, go ahead, Matt. Just so.
Overall, I think that as a standalone movie, this is actually really pretty good. It stands on its own merits and also manages to make enough twists and turns that even veterans of the series could actually see the differences and that acknowledge that maybe for this particular interpretation that these changes weren't all for the worst either.
All right. Tim?
Or I think this was a better movie than Doctor Who and the Daleks. Part of that is because of Bernard Cribbins.
It helps.
Cribbins. It was a lighthearted family romp that was a bit too benign at times, but other than that, I thought it was a good movie.
Okay, Bill.
First off, I'm going to say my initial instinct would be to compare this to the Dalek Invasion of Earth, which is really not fair because there's a lot of stuff involved in the Doctor Who ongoing plot that they couldn't really replicate here, and that being my favorite episode of the first Doctor era. When I look at this as a sequel to the movie itself, it does fare a lot better, although I do still think it's a bit inferior to Doctor Who and the Daleks, largely because of, or at least partially because of the loss of threat with the music, and that just has so much to do with the tone. It sets the movie off on the wrong foot, and it doesn't really recover that much from there.
All right, Aaron?
I really enjoyed the reinterpretation of the story. It doesn't really even bother me that much that they, you know, originally they changed the Doctor from a Time Lord to a human, and yeah, it still works out fine for me and is still fairly entertaining. Better than the first one, even.
All right. Well, my opinion is the fact that, yes, this movie is actually better than its predecessor, Doctor Who and the Daleks. I still prefer the original serial to this, but this movie, for one, does not hold so rigidly to the plot format. It's willing to take differences. The characterization of the actors is so much more better, except for Cushing, who is right on par with his previous performance. It is more amusing in the right ways rather than the wrong ways. And while the music often fails, it sometimes often succeeds as well, depending on the scene. So, all in all, I think this movie gets a bum rap by people who rate it as being absolutely terrible. And yeah. Rates it as being as Doctor and the Daleks being much better. So let's go to our scores. Matt.
I believe last time I gave it a 3.5 for Doctor Who and the Daleks, just for the sake of Peter Cushing. I think because we have an overall improvement of casting for a mass majority of this movie, I can safely say I bumped this up to a 4.
4 flat. All right. Helps if I turn my number lock on. All right. Oops.
Never
Bill.
Turn that number lock off.
I'm going to say a 3.0 on this one, and I'm expecting to be the low vote.
Yeah, I suspect you are going to be the low vote, as you are the only one that seems to like this movie less than its predecessor. Tim.
I'm going to give this a 4 flat as well. It was, like I said, it was better than Doctor Who and the Daleks, but on the same time, it wasn't all that remarkable.
Yeah.
As movies go.
Okay, Aaron.
I enjoyed it a lot, so I'm gonna give it a 4.
All right. And I am going to agree with everybody on the panel except Bill, and give this a 4.0. Much like in the previous session, everybody gave it a 3.5, but me, who gave it a 3.
Man, why do you have to be so agreeable?
So that takes our combined score up to a 3.8.
Woo!
A lot higher than the 3.4.
Yes, that's like a half grade up. So if they could have kept pushing, maybe they could have pushed this up into a 4.0 and higher. I would have loved to have seen a series of Daleks.
With the next Dalek stories, I don't think they really could have pulled out that much better of a movie. I mean, Power of the Daleks would have made a very interesting adaptation.
That would have to wait a while, though. So by the time that came around, the Daleks would have been their own spinoff. So, yeah. I could see a Dalek movie franchise if they ever got the guts to try it again.
Sometimes I really hate doing this kind of stuff on this computer.
Can I be one of the Dalek voice actors? Please tell me I can be one of the Dalek voice actors.
You can be one of the Dalek voice actors.
I don't know, Matt.
Do you doubt my voice acting?
I'm trying to think what else they could have done that season. That's a good question, actually. I'm trying to think of another major story from season 2 that does not feature Daleks.
See, the problem is, if you look at the trailer to this, the actual Doctor Who part of this was actually played down.
True. That's why he was left out of the title this time.
Yeah, they mentioned, Cushing in his most action-packed role ever.
Mm-hmm. They don't even mention that he's playing the Doctor.
No, they don't. They just say...
This one I'll mention Cushing because, he was doing the Hammer films at the time, so let's get the big name up there, at least for his name's sake. Yeah, they were definitely skewing to more Daleks.
If kept going on to the 70s, and we would have had Peter Cushing as Doctor Who and Christopher Lee as Davros. No wait,
Davros as the Master.
Did Christopher did Cushing have any other film arch rivals?
He actually had Darth Vader's body actor as a nemesis a couple times.
Yeah,
I think Michael Goff would have been Davros.
I'm trying to think of anyone else.
Okay, so Daleks Invasion Earth 2150 is number 54 in our ratings of episodes. It is right below The Girl in the Fireplace, a Moffat episode from the Russell T. Davies era.
Mm-hmm.
Two below Enemy of the World. Mm. And right above the Third Doctor episode, Day of the Daleks.
Ooh.
And just above also Robot of Sherwood and Flatline.
Nice.
And I might actually add, it is 5 places above the original The Daleks.
Hmm.
Boom. Just blew the minds of everyone else that's reviewed this and gave it a crappy score.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's not that bad.
I could really see them doing this, Mark.
It is, however, a good 33 places below the Dalek Invasion of Earth, which is number 21 at a 4.3.
Yeah. But they kept improving every time they did one of these. I could really see them trying to make a franchise out of this, but sadly they just let go.
That would have been interesting.
What if it had turned out well in the box office? Yeah.
Uh-huh.
What if people did give it a shot and went, that's not actually too bad.
I'm kind of wondering if the fact that they didn't put Doctor Who in the title
might have caused it to suffer.
And the fact that I think Dalek Mania, while, still a thing, wasn't as big of a thing.
Mm-hmm.
It had kind of come and was waning by the time this came out in 66.
Maybe.
Are we still filming?
Yes.
Yes.
So, anyway.
All right, so that does it. Bill, take us out.
Okay. Phil, if you enjoy listening to us, please like the video and subscribe on YouTube, Twitch, and or Mixcloud. You can follow us for news and updates on Facebook and Twitter. And if you want to support us, you can go on over to patreon.com/unearthlypodcast. Don't forget to join us next week for our final episode of this season before we have our rather short but still effective season break. And that will be Terror of the Zygons.
Returning back to, of course, the actual canon Doctor Who. And is the only Zygon episode prior to New Who with Tom Baker. And Sarah Jane Smith.
Zygon and Sarah.
Tune in then.
I miss you, Sarah.
That's true. Tom Baker has been in every Zygon episode to date, but he probably won't be in the next one.
Sadly, he won't be in the next one.
Unless he will be in the next one.
As a secret cameo.
That would be it. That would be Moffat really keeping a secret under wraps.
No kidding, right?
The doctors hang around on Earth, and there's just like, I told you to look for it. Why haven't you done it yet?
I've been busy. Shh, go.
Would you like a jelly baby? Well, you won't get one.
You haven't been looking for Gallifrey properly. Now go find it, and then you'll get
a
jelly baby.
Tune in next week, people.
Good night.
Bye.
See ya.